I'm very happy to talk to you about well-behaved strong types in C++ today. I will hope you will learn something. So let's dive into it. First, start with a motivation. So why would you even consider strong types? That's a bit of rhetorical questions, but let's look into some function signatures from some open source projects. Maybe we can learn something and maybe we get a good motivation. So let's start with Qt Curator. So latest version, 4.14. It's a very active developed project, but it's a big project, so it has many, many corners. I don't want to poke anybody's code, so I just searched for some random function signatures, and that's what I came up with. So anything wrong with this method and function signature? Yes, import is a good name, not too bad. Import, nice. But then we have two bool arguments. I would say it's very easy to confuse those arguments. And what's worse, not everybody uses these arguments, so they are defaults. And who would remember to add a false or a true at a method when it's calling? Okay, but there's another gem hidden in the C++ source code. That's this. It's like 8 integer arguments for one constructor function. It's very deep inside the internals of the Qt Curator, so it's in the QML designer, but still 8 in arguments. That's very confusing. I wouldn't suggest to do any method with 8 arguments, but 8 integer arguments, way well to confuse. Luckily, all those arguments are pairs, so width and height, and margin and so on, all come in pairs. So, but you still have to remember in which order the width and the margin and the cell count and the offsets would go. So it's a bit confusing. And there's one more I want to show you. That's this method. Move to next word, good name for it. But then we have very confusing arguments. So we have a bool, an integer, a bool, and a bool again. So to be fair, it's an internal function that is only inside the C++, but still, it's very awkward. Okay, that's an application. Maybe if you take more care about the libraries. So let's look into Qt itself. So latest incarnation, Qt 6. It's still the same in Qt 5. Those methods don't change signature very often, but we have something like a sprite sheet. We have an add sprite method with just 4 integer arguments. Maybe for a sprite, it's clear that you have an X and Y coordinate and a width and a height, but still it's confusing to have so many integer arguments. And there's also something I came up with is a Qt texture image data that has a method to retrieve the data from a specific layer, a face in the midmap level. So 3 integer arguments, quite a bit difficult. Somebody in the chat came up with that C++ will also allow to convert bools to integers and vice versa. So when the final method, not just the bool and the integer argument, and here it's not even clear which order those arguments go. That's why I picked it. This is not limited to basic types. So this is to be true in a shader program, but here we are using vectors, and it's the same in C++ or any other programming language. And we can encode in a vector with 2 floats. So let's use it for everything. Let's do it for a pixel coordinate, for a zoom level, and a UV coordinate. And the result, who knows what this means? In this particular case, it's intensity values as a result, nothing to do with a position or something. A common practice also is to encode colors into vectors. So 3 floats, RGB, that's nice. That's the problem. That's the main motivation to do something about it. So let's go fix that. But before we jump into strong types, what options do we have in C++? So the first thing that comes into my mind is replace a bool with an enum. So enums are better bools. So for example, in that I showed you, we had text and binary. So is binary. But output format is a real thing. And creating a bool is actually making you think about what does it mean, is binary. It's not about is binary, it's about the output format that you want to dump your data into. So, and it also may make your interface more extendable because a bool is a finite set, so it's only true and false. But the enum, you can extend it and maybe add JSON or something like that at the output point. If you have a function with a bool, just like always a better way to do that. And then there's another very common thing. If we have a function with a bool, maybe those two states of the function are not doing the same thing. We want to stick one single purpose in each function and each thing we do. Maybe it's a better idea to have a function that dumps as a binary and another one that dumps as a text. And in this case that I showed you, there was an intent argument that was used for both, but I would suspect without reading any code that the indentation is not relevant for the binary format. So why do we have one function signature for both? Wouldn't it be better to have one function that does one thing well? We still have more options before we come to types. How about a fluent API? For example, we start with dump as text and then set the indentation and finally save it to our output file. Fluent APIs are a bit cumbersome to develop, but they show that you care about the API and want to do something well. As I've shown, there are many possibilities, but then we have the types as well. So let's start over with some weak type aliases. That's the common, easiest to do thing in C++. And it would make our APIs speak more. For example, here in the example I showed, we can say it's not an int, it's a layer. It has a meaning. We can do this for all the types, and then our API would look like that. I would say this API looks much better and more understandable than just three integers. There's one issue. When we call this function, we still don't see what we are doing. So there's an option to say the first one is a layer, but it's not really different. If we would do the first one as a face, then it would still accept that as a compiler. So that's where strong types come into play. But as a first thing, I would always suggest to make aliases for your types, and to introduce strong types later is very easy. But if everything is an int, then yeah, you have to do a lot of work later for introducing strong types. So if you don't do anything from this talk, then do this and set up to enhance and write better code. So let's go for strong types then. What we want is basically not a weak alias that substitutes an int. We want something better. So what is the better thing? We want basically to have a structure that expresses the meaning. Let's make that a template so we don't have to redefine it all the time. And this template would accept two template arguments. The first one would be the stored type. So that's natural. And we have to make a distinction. So how do you differentiate this type from all the other instantiations of the template? That's the tag type. The implementation is, for basic strong type, very simple. We just store the type that we are storing and a value. You can make it more elaborate and get a get method and so on, but you don't have to do it. This is enough to be a strong type. So if we use our very basic template here, then yeah, our layer definition would look like this. One very interesting trick is that we can create a new type, this layer tag, in place on the template instantiation. So we don't need an implementation for the layer tag because it's only used to differentiate our strong type there from all the other instantiation of type. So it looks different from a face and a mid-map level. And our function would look the same as before. As I said, well prepared if you're just using aliases. But now we are first, when we call it, to instantiate all our strong types. And by the magic of C++ constructor generation and so on, this just works. And now our call site is also looking really informative. So we know the first one is a layer, and if we try to pass it as a face, then it's wrong. It wouldn't compile. So it feels like named arguments again. But that's not all. We want more. So we want more features because this opaque type, doesn't do anything. We always have to destructure to do something with it. So for example, you would want to compare two types. So if you have two faces, you want to compare those. See if they're equal. Very common operation, but not all types can be compared, so that's tricky. And there might be an interest in making them orderable, so you can use them in a standard map as a key. But not all types are orderable, and what's the natural order? So we cannot do that with our template immediately. And maybe you want to do mass operations, like adding two faces together and get another one. Printing is also very common. So you want to print it to standard out or standard format in C++20. That's possible. You can add overloads to do that. And then there are custom operations. But then that should make you think, because if we are adding custom operations, then why we are using a common template in anyways? So just do the struct. Okay. If you want to read more about that, then there are a series of blog posts that started in 2016. Jonathan Miller basically introduced his version that is part of his TypeSafe library of a strong type dev. The blog article is very informative, so very good motivation also. Yeah, that was the starter. Then there was another blog post by Arne Mertz, same year, a bit later, and has simplified C++ blog. So also very worth reading, and it's independent of any library, so it's just analyzing the problem. But Jonathan Bokhara, in the same year, started a series of blog posts about this whole topic. And he tries to visit all angles of strong types in C++. So all of them are a very good read. And if you have time, you should read them, even though they are like 4 years old now, or 5 years. But that's not our journey for today. We have a different thing to talk about, because not all strong types are well behaved. So there are some disadvantages of using this strategy. What's the thing with strong types here? So the first thing is, if we want to compose strong types, so we have our layer that we defined before, and now we have, for example, a vector of layers. But not any vector of layers, we have meaning to that. So these are the active layers of layers. And the definition doesn't look too awful, just like before. But if you look into your debugger, you will see something like this. So these types become very complex and very long, because a vector also has an allocator, and this allocator also based on the strong type. So if you go some layers deep, then that will become strange. And I've seen that. Okay, but there are more problems. Basically, because we are still using aliases, just that alias instantiating a template now, there's no way to forward define our types. And if we go deep and nest our types, we might get some headers where we want to forward declare a type, even though it's a strong type. And that's not even possible. And you won't realize this problem until you hit it. And then it will hit you hard, and there's no way around it. So the question comes now, what can we do about it? So let's go back to the fundamentals. What we wanted to introduce anyway. So our strong type def just has to be something that is not a weak alias. What's the simplest thing in C++ that is not a weak alias? It's just a class or a struct. So why are we not doing that? And for example, in our layer definition, it's not much worse than writing a using and a tag type. Just using that. So we don't even need to have a member type stored in our class, because we can reflect on the value of the type. And if you want to go shorter, you can put it all on one line and don't even write value there, so just we. And that what I suggested in other talks, just to make it short. Looks a bit cumbersome because we have two semicolons on the same line, but yeah, it's not too bad for SlideWear. But then what do we do about all the features? So we still want to compare this, and this structure is not comparable because there's no comparison operator overloaded. So yeah, unfortunately, I don't have a really cool solution to that. Just go back to macro hell and use a macro. Doesn't look too bad, and also the macro implementation is not too complex. So that's my current solution for that. And that's not that I am the only one who came up with this solution and this discussion as well. So there was a very nice blog post in 2018 by Vincent Salzhau on the Jonathan Bokara's blog, FluentCPP. And he wrote about using just structures, as I told you here, in as replacement for strong types. And he doesn't come up with a final solution. There's no better or worse. It's just different. And sometimes the trade-off is beneficial to use custom structures, and sometimes strong type devs are enough using the templates. And there's another blog post I wanted to point you at. That's the C++ Strong Types Holy Grail by Dusan Javonich. I cannot pronounce his name correctly. He wrote it in 2019. Basically, also suggests to use macros instead of writing the struct all over again. And the main benefit for using macros is also that you can change it in one place. So if you have structure defined everywhere, if you want to add a feature, then you have to go through all your code and replace it. And even though macros are bad in many places, I think here it's a very good use case. And yeah. I don't want to bore you here in the talk with the implementation of these macros, because they can get complex depending on what you need. I want to hint you at my implementation, basically. It's after some incarnations. So there's the CoC++19 library. That's basically a collection of libraries, and there's a strong 19 lib that's part of it. And that's all it does is implement strong types with macros. And one thing is it defines two kinds of macros, one to declare a strong type. So you don't even have to have an implementation of the type. That's only useful if you want to do something like schemas that I talked last year. And there's also the define strong that basically defines a strong type, as we talked about it here. It has some nice implementation details. For example, it handles brackets. So if you usually use macros, you might not be aware that comma separates arguments. And if you have template arguments like a vector or a tuple that contain commas between angle brackets, those are treated as different arguments because macros don't understand C++. And what we do about it is we use round brackets and eliminate them in the macro itself. We have a is strong trait, so you can basically investigate if this type that you get as a template argument is a strong type. Because when everything is a custom struct, then you wouldn't know otherwise. If it's a template alias or template instantiation, then you know by querying if it's an instantiation of this template. But if everything is in custom struct, then you need a trait. We added that, and we also added names. So you can ask for a string representation of the name of each strong type. That's very easily doable with a macro, because we can create strings from the names. And we also allow custom tags. We use that, for example, to tag if something is a unit meter or something like that. And we also overloaded standard format and standard OStream, so you can print your type values. And it's also not just printing the value itself, it's also printing the name of the type. And we also have support for less and hash if you demand so. So not every type has to support it, but every type that uses the find strong has to be comparable. That was a trade-off I was willing to give. So if you're interested, just look at GitHub, BasicCPP 17 and CoreCPP 19. So is that all? No, no, we have more. So if you talk about well-behaved strong types, we can look into the Chrono library. Chrono library supports a very interesting way of strong types. So one thing in the Chronos library is the duration. And the duration is not just a class, it's a templated class that is templated over representation, so the underlying type, and not a tag, but a period. And this period allows us to say, okay, by default it's ratio 1. So a second is a duration with a period of 1. But a nanosecond, the same representation, so both are int normally, or in the standard it's undefined, but it's basically an integer. And the period of a nanosecond is nano, standard nano. With this, we get a new inspiration to do more with strong types. So, for example, we want to implement physical units. And I chose a very simple example, electrical units. Again, we would define a macro to define our custom duration, but it's basically the same kind of templates, just like a duration. We can instantiate, again, like say ohms is a concrete resistance with a ratio of 1. And kilo ohms would then be an implementation of the resistance with standard kilo as a ratio. Okay, and if we have this kind of representation for our physical electrical units here, then we can also implement concrete operations on that. So, for example, we want to divide our potential by the current. And this gives us resistance. So basically, we are doing like volts divided by amperes gives us ohms. Many operations become very simple, even though you get the benefit of strong types here. And yet the strong type is not a concrete type, it's a strong template type. So if you imagine the potential underlying value is just a double, and the current as well, and the resistance also. So we have come a very long way from just using the underlying representations to expressing meaning in our functions. And I also found a very nice blog article about that. And Barney Delar gave many talks about strong types and also has a pretty neat library, space types, that tries to solve this issue with vectors and points in 3D space. And also, like, you have points in different coordinate systems, and you have to transform points between those. And all this with very strong types, so you don't get confused or anything. So it's a very good read if you want to know more about 3D space strong types. They just behave like the Kronos library in the standard C++. Basically all I want to talk about today. Let's go to the summary. So we have seen that weak types often smell. So they're not bad per se, but we can do better. So we have also seen that we have many strategies like enums for bools and fluent APIs and so on. And many times strong types are good help. They're not the only ultimate solution, but they help a lot to make very, very good APIs that are very hard to misuse and very easy to use right. What I couldn't show you is that the usage of strong types doesn't take such a big burden as you might imagine to unpack and pack the type all the times. There's a reason why the C++ standard doesn't come with a strong type, that it's implemented in the C++ language. So it actually depends. And you have to weigh your requirements and what is actually necessary and what is not necessary. I hope I could inspire you a bit to think about these issues and leave you with a big, it depends, the final conclusion of everything. Actually consider your use case. I am Andreas Reischuk, also known as Opmind on the interwebs, and I give on-site trainings and online trainings for C++, Qt, Clean Code. If you're interested, you can hire me. You can also hire our company. It's HiddenEgg Software. We do a lot of consulting and help you build better software. Consider working with us. We create Qt UIs locally in Dresden and worldwide. Speaking of Dresden, there's a C++ user group. Please bring up your talks. We're still 10 open slots left. So we have video recordings and hopefully technical difficulties will go away. Once you can visit Dresden again, you're very welcome. Give you a city tour. And I will also do a talk at your local user group if you want so. One project of my heart is the Rebuild Language project, where I try to investigate possibilities for better languages, better tools to express ourselves. It's a compiler built in C++ 20, so it's using all the latest features like coroutines and so on. So if you have interest, contact me. We can collaborate on that. So that's my final slide. Thank you for your attention, and I'm awaiting your questions now.
Hey, thank you very much.
Thank you.
I also I find the strong type tips is very, very helpful and very, very important in chasing down and eliminating bugs. One thing that I have trouble with at work is that we use some software that communicates with the hardware and drivers, where we have certain structures or structs that are what's called the bit fields, several fields that aren't exactly bytes or ints, but maybe like a 7-bit number or a 4-bit number. And I really tried, and I don't have a very good way to have strong type defs that are, not an exact multiple of 8 bits, which is frustrating to me. But I don't know if anyone has had a similar issue and what solutions could be found for these types of things.
I didn't have those issues yet, but what I can imagine immediately is that you have to differentiate between storing types and also actually using the type. So once you unpack your bit structure, you get integer again, or a byte, or whatever is best representation on your platform. But storing and using types is two different stories. So this DORT system should be treated like that. And embedded systems are normally kind of bad with handling that because yeah, the storage in memory is the same as your representation in your language. But you should make these two distinct things. So one structure that stores the type, and when you exit it, you get back strong type, for example, that is internally represented by an integer. But when you set the value again, you store it as a bit representation. So basically, you create an interface for that and hide the nasty details that bit fields are just integers.
Yeah, agree to. Hi, Roy. Hi, Andreas. Thank you very much for the session. When Roy told about that bit fields, I also only have experience working with old style C code, where in embedded programming we use the we have many use cases where we have to manage bit fields. So usually we use like structure with bit fields as a common approach, and then for like for example. Maybe if it is in some communication protocol, there will be a protocol defined, and using those old style bitmarks and stuff like that, we parse the packet which is received and into different according to the bit lengths. So I don't know, but I'm not sure about the new ways of implementing in modern C++ for that. Yeah, it's as Roy told, it is. It's bad. yeah, thank you. If there are any newer ideas, it would be great. Thank you.
I'm not aware of anything new about that. I know there was spoken somewhere in the standard meetings about bit fields and some new features for that, but I'm not aware of that. If it's just legacy C, then I would say it's the same. So. If it's just a protocol that can have some bits in it, extract those bits immediately as integer values or as actually bits like bool or something like that. That's also what we are doing in our application, but I'm not aware of your constraints or from the platform if an integer is too large or something like that.
So? Yeah, that makes sense, Andreas. Yeah, no constraints so far, but like regarding maybe readability or like when more high level people look into the code, maybe when they see these bit fields and all, some colleagues may not be familiar with that. Like so, we, as you said, like we do a interface layer. So that not to hide much of the inner details, and will give like for example the correct fields, get a functions for fields and set a functions for fields, so that those inner implementation details are hidden with that interface. Thank you.
Yes, that's also something that we did, and we like defined a template type called the. Bit field that it has it's templated on like an underlying type like an int or a short, and it's also templated on the number of bits, and it's it has a constructor that validates in runtime that it can accept the underlying type and make sure that it doesn't overflow, and then our structs like Honey mentioned have all those fields as private. They have setter functions that accept the template type, and that way whoever calls the setter function knows that they need to create an object of the right size, but still many people don't like using setter functions. They prefer doing things like assignment operators, etc., and I couldn't find a cleaner solution.
Finding the best API that works for all your colleagues is very difficult because everybody has a different mindset or constraints, what he prefers. So designing APIs that work for everyone is like a mystery that never works. But what you tell me is it looks already very good if everything is private and you have to use accessors and shouldn't be much of a hassle.
I guess in the chat, Manoj is mentioning about protocol buffers of Google. Has somebody used that? Manoj, have you used that? thank you.
We have used that, but
yeah, we have also used them a lot.
Depending on your use case, that might be a bit hard on the CPU time because that has to encode
yeah,
and control everything.
That's true. But I've seen in a lot of cases that people overuse protocol buffers and then it becomes a real pain. Like I remember in my previous organization, we had this application where right from configuration to communication, everything was happening on protobuf and it was real pain.
Sorry, by real pain, you mean like, I don't have any idea about protocol buff. Is it like the library itself?
It's heavy, that's true, but the thing is that protocol buff, if you see the advantages point of view, it's really advantages. For example, it works on the binary level where you can define stuff as text and then it has some mechanism by which it compresses data and it can send, and it is cross-platform, so it's like you can write a C++ application and a Python application can actually receive the same data without any problem because they have libraries in like all the languages. But in my organization, we were using it for like a lot of stuff. So it was getting so difficult at the time to manage all these things because for every protobuf, you define a configuration files and then things like that. It was like too much. We actually were working on a financial organization where if anybody's aware that the fixed protocol is a very good norm to do that. So we were doing like fix to protobuf conversion, protobuf to fix, and there were like other things that were happening on protobuf. It was a little too much used. So that's why I was saying that. I'm not saying that protobuf are bad as such, but if you use them too much, then yeah. Because they are so extensible, so people try to use them for like any number of things.
Thanks for the info, Prakar. Manoj, who is speaking?
Thank you for your question.